Himself. 8. I want to begin reading at verse number 18. Then I'm going to go down and read some latter parts of the chapter, but I want you to stay in your Bible at this chapter if you would, and I want to share with you some things today that God's put on my heart. Matthew chapter number 18, verse number 18. Now when Jesus saw great multitudes about him, he gave commandment to depart unto the other side. Now you know, in between this, the disciples are going to run into a storm, and Jesus is going to calm the storm. Now go down to verse 28. And when he was come to the other side into the country of the Gadarenes, there met him two possessed with devils coming out of the tombs, exceeding fierce, so that no man might pass by that way. And behold, they cried out, saying, What have we to do with thee, Jesus, thou Son of God? Art thou come hither to torment us before the time? There was a good way off from them a herd of many swine feeding. So the devils besought him, saying, If thou cast us out, suffer us to go away into the herd of swine. And he said unto them, Go. And when they were come out, they went into the herd of swine. Behold, the herd of swine ran violently down a steep place of the sea and perished in the waters. And they that kept them fled and went their ways into the city and told everything what was befallen to the possessed of the devils. Behold, the whole city came out to meet Jesus. And when they saw him, they besought him that he would depart out of their coast. Now the reason that I read both of those passages is because I am interested in what takes place in the middle of this passage. I'm interested this morning in this thought, this storm may not be for you. This storm may not be for you. Let's bow together and pray. Father, we thank you so much for the opportunity we have to be in the house of God today. Thank you, Lord, for the good spirit. God, the way the choir has sung. Ms. Chesney, thank you for the good song she sung for us today. Thank you for our visitors and members alike. Lord, I pray today may you bless the Word of God and use the Word of God for your honor and for your glory. And we will thank you and we will praise you in Christ's name. And all God's people said, Amen. Amen. You can be seated. The help of the Lord today, I want to preach on this thought. And I guess I can shorten the title and preach on this storm is not for you. Now, this may be somewhat of a different preaching that you have heard on chapter number 8 of Matthew. But as the Lord began to give me thoughts about this, I wanted to share just a little bit. I thought about, as I mentioned earlier, stated earlier about my friend, Brother Todd, that went home to be with the Lord this past week. And I thought about the storm that his family is going through. I also thought about others and the storms that they faced during their life. And no doubt you and I realize today that storms are a part of life. Can I get an amen to that? No doubt if we live long enough, if we're saved long enough, if we serve God long enough, we are going to face storms in our life. But sometimes I'm afraid that we do not know why that storm is there. Sometimes I'm afraid we do not understand, and many times we may never understand what God is doing in our lives during this storm. So what I decided to do, and I was studying for this, is I began to think about storms through our lives, and I began to put them somewhat in a category, a little bit of where they come from. And then I want to share with you why I believe that in the disciples' life, this storm was not a storm that they generated. It was not a good storm that I'll deal with in a moment, but it was a guiding storm. And I'll share that with you in just a moment. I want you to think about this throughout the message. Why are the disciples in the storm? Why do the disciples find themselves in a storm on this particular sea, on this particular boat? Why are they in this storm? All of us in our life, sometime or another, will ask the question why. All of
of us sometimes, I'm not going to lie to you, I'm going to be honest with you. Many times in my life as a Christian, many times in my life, now 31 years in the ministry, I've asked God why. I'm going to be honest. You say, well, preacher, you really ought not do that. Well, you pray for us weaker brethren if you would. But I want to say this today. Even one of the seven sayings from the cross, Jesus said, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Oh, I know he was fully God, and I know he understood God's plan, but he was also man, and he came to this world to be a high priest for you and I, and to be touched with the feeling of our infirmities. But I want to say this today, even in that human sense, he cried out, why? You find that messianic psalms even back in the Old Testament. But I want you to understand that this storm the disciples were in, I do not believe was for them. And I'll show you that in just a moment. Let me talk a little bit about storms though. Boy, I'm telling you what, there is no doubt we all face storms. I'm going to give you this category. First of all, I want to say this. Some storms are generated storms. In other words, we go through some storms in our life because we simply do not do the will of God. We simply go through storms in our life because we step away from God. We are not where we need to be with God. And we generate storms in our own lives. I want to say something to you. I deal with people all the time that ask me for advice, that ask me for counsel, that want me to help them. And I give them what I believe to be godly advice. What I believe to be what the Bible says. But you know what many times they do with that? They disregard what the Bible says. They disregard what the Word of God is teaching them. They disregard it. You know what they do? They go ahead and do what they want to do in spite of godly counsel. What happens? They generate storms in their life. Don't you listen? We know the greatest picture of that. That'd be the book of Jonah, chapter number 1. The Bible says, the word of the Lord came unto Jonah, the son of Amittai, saying, arise and go to Nineveh, that great city, and cry against it. For their wickedness has come up before me. But Jonah rose up to flee unto Tarsus from the presence of the Lord and went down to Joppa. You ever notice when you get away from God, you're always going down? And he found a ship going to Tarsus. So he paid the fare thereof and went down into it to go to them unto Tarsus from the presence of the Lord. How many of you realize you can't get away from the presence of God? How many of you realize that God is not only omnipotent, but he's also omnipresent, and you cannot get away from the presence of God? So I want you to understand something. Jonah tried to get away from God, trying to get away from the presence of God, but you can't do that. You know what you're going to create in your life when you try to get away from the presence of God? You're going to create a storm. Look back in your Bible just a moment. The Bible says, but the Lord sent out, well, you don't have to look, I'm actually reading somewhere different, but the Lord sent out a great wind into the sea. What is that? Storm. And there was a mighty tempest in the sea. What was that? Storm. So that the ship was like to be broken. Generated storms. I don't have to tell you what happened, but it was in the well of an experience. Amen? And you know what happened. The storm came in Jonah's life. And that storm was generated because of Jonah's disobedience to God. Now I realize in ethics as a pastor, I can't look at someone and say to them, you created this mess. I want to. I want to look at people sometimes and say to them, if you hadn't been so ridiculous, if you'd have listened, if you'd have done right, if you would have just trusted God, you wouldn't have got yourself in this mess. And there's occasions that I do say that. There's times I do look at somebody and say, well, you know what? Yeah, you know, as you grew up as a boy, as you married, you made it. Right? Generating storms. Now, I still feel sorry for those that have generated storms. I somewhat can be empathetic for those that have generated storms. And I guess I can literally even be somewhat moved because of it. Because I don't want to see anybody that I pastor go through storms. But I'm going to tell you something. There's a lot of people that just generate storms. I mean, you make a mess in your life, you're going to get in a storm. Whether you like it or not, you're going to get in a storm. I've seen families go through storms. I've seen individuals go through storms, and it was generated. You're not going to do anything in your life that will generate a storm in your life. You're not getting married to the wrong person. You are not going to the wrong place. You're not doing the wrong thing. You're not getting involved in the wrong stuff. That's going to get you in a mess. You need to make sure you don't generate the storm. Second of all, there's another storm I call, and this is, it seems like an oxymoron, I call good storms. And that seems like an oxymoron. It don't even seem like it even fits together. What are good storms? Well, let me just give you what the Bible says. The Bible says in the book of James, my brethren, count it all joy when you fall into divers temptations, knowing this, that the trying of your faith worketh patience. In other words, here's what James is saying. James is saying, this is not a generated storm. This could be a good storm in your life. Say, what do you mean? God may allow you to go through something that will make you better. God may allow you to go through something that's going to help you to become more for Him. Hey, can I tell you this? I cannot say during that storm that you're going to jump up and down. I cannot say during that storm that you're going to say, hallelujah, I'm glad the car broke down. Hallelujah, I'm glad the house caught on fire. Well, praise God, I'm glad I'm sick and in the hospital. I don't expect you to do that. But here's what I am saying to you. Sometimes God allows us to go through trials in order that He may develop us and make us into what He wants us to be. So you got to understand that my period would be a good storm in our life. Something you go through in your life that makes you better for the cause of Christ. Something you go through in your life that makes you better. Something in your life that says, you know what? I don't like going through this. I was unhappy to go through this. I don't understand going through this, but I want to be better when I come out of it. Everybody, listen to me just a moment. For those of you who have been through things like that in your life, you weren't thanking God for it when you were going through it. But after it's over and said now, and you look back at it, how many of us would have to say, boy, God showed up during that storm. God was there to help me. God gave me what I needed. God touched my life. God helped me. How many times do we go through them good storms? I say there's oxymoron. I don't know, you know, we call them sometimes summer storms. You know, and we don't necessarily like, I mean, I do like thunder lightning. I'm kind of weird that way. I like storms. I've always wanted to be a hurricane chaser. I like storms. I like to fly. I don't like to fly, but I like to fly into the middle of a hurricane and see it. I just think that'd be cool. And so I guess, brother, if you want to, we'll get you on. I don't know about them kind of little planes you fly. But anyway, he flies in planes. He's got a, I don't know, with a trolling motor on the back. That made me nervous. But he said, Rich, I'm going to do it. He said, Rich, you ought to try it sometime. Then he started showing me how many trees he run. I told him, like, no, thank you, man. I don't want to do that. All right. But anyway, what I'm saying is, I'm saying sometimes we refer to them as good storms. But I want to deal with those things. The one I want to deal with is what I call guiding storms. Guiding storms. Do you believe God can put you in a storm in your life sometime that all He's trying to do is to get you somewhere? Do you believe God can put you in a storm in your life and what He's trying to do is He's trying to direct you and get you to a certain place? See, if you're not careful, you'll read the Bible and you'll miss out. And the very fact that you miss out on is when something starts in one place and it ends somewhere else, it may be the whole consolidation of what you just read, and you'll miss out on it if you don't realize what God is doing. Sometimes what we have is we have storms that literally are guiding storms. Now, I want you to look back in the Bible just a moment. Look at chapter 8 and verse 18 again. Don't miss this. The Bible says in chapter 8 verse 18, now when Jesus saw great multitudes about Him, He gave commandment to depart unto the other side. Now, don't you listen to me. When I say great commandment to depart unto the other side, do you understand what He's doing? What He's doing is saying this, I'm commanding you, I want you to do exactly this, to depart unto the other side. Let me ask you this, what does He mean by that? What is He saying by that? He's telling His disciples, this is what I want you to do. Now, you say, preacher, what's the big deal about that? Here's the big deal about that. Look back in your Bible. The Bible tells us, and when He was entered into a ship, verse 23, His disciples followed Him. Now, what are guided storms? Watch this. There's two things you've got to notice about this guided storm. Number one is this. They were in the will of God. Are you listening? They were in the will of God. Preacher, are you telling me that I can get in a boat or that I can get in a storm and I can be in that storm and yet I'm in the will of God? Let me ask you a question. Who told them to get in the boat? The Lord Jesus. Who knew the storm was going to be there before they ever got there? The Lord Jesus. So in other words, they were in the will of God in the middle of the storm.
Preacher, you're telling me that I can be in the will of God in my life and go through a storm? I am most definitely telling you that. I promise you. Hey, listen, I know what it is. Man, I'm telling you, I left my first church after almost 14 years. Been at this about the same distance time now. And I can tell you this. Man, it was stormy when I mean, the church was doing great. Well, Mr. Sim, everything was good. But I'm telling you, boy, in the will of God, that created storm. What's wrong with him? What's he doing? What's not like him anymore? What the Lord's going on? Blah, 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 blah. And so what happened was, is that in the middle of the will of God, all of a sudden, storm clouds start coming. I'm going to tell you something. Sometimes you can be in the will of God. Well, preacher, I don't understand. I'm trying to do everything right for the Lord, and it seems like I'm going through storms. Welcome to life. Amen. I told you over and over and over again, you're not promised anything. You know, maybe I should say it in a different phraseology here. You're promised things, but let me say this. You're not immune from anything. You and I are not immune from storms. God does not owe us not to go through a storm. God does not owe us not to have trials. You don't find that in the Bible. Matter of fact, some of the greatest servants of God, the Word of God. Some of the greatest servants of God, the Word of God, went through storms. Think about it. Some of the most godliest people I've ever known have went through storms, have battled storms in their life. And so I'm telling you, you can be in the will of God and still go through a storm. But I want you to get a hold of something. If you do that, I want you to understand God knows where you are, and He knows you're in the storm. And matter of fact, sometimes I believe He guides you right into it. See how quiet it got me in. Let me tell you why. Well, God that loved me wouldn't guide me into a storm. He wouldn't if He's going to use it for a purpose.
Right.
He guided you into a storm if He's going to do something in your life or He's going to do something somewhere else. See, don't miss out on what I'm reading now. Stay with me the whole chapter. Here's the deal. We're going to the other side. Why are we going to the other side? Well, you don't even know that. You just need to know you need to get on the boat and do the will of God. There's a reason we're going, but you need to get on the boat and do the will of God. So first of all, they were in the will of God. Second of all, but you watch this. They were with God. Amen. When they're on that boat, not only are they in the will of God, but when they're on that boat, they are with God. He's on the boat. Jesus was God. You believe that, don't you? He's on the boat. And now, not only are they in the will of God, but now all of a sudden, they're with God on the boat. Jesus. You know what that tells me? No matter what storm I go through, I'm glad He's with me. I'm glad He's with me. Now those generated storms, you try to leave Him. He knows where He's at. But you try to do it on your own. I mean, listen, I was in church. Man got up one night. I've seen this happen two or three times now. Man got up and he said at the end of service, Pastor, I want to tell the church and ask them to forgive me. You know, preachers get real nervous when people do that. Or like anybody messing in the church, saying things that I don't know them well or that I'm not unsure what they're doing. But here's another man that got up, and this man got up, and when he got up, he began to tell about how he wasn't a good husband, how he let his wife down, how he didn't do right, how he didn't treat her right, now he's lost her. That's a generated storm. He said, if I'd have done right, if I'd have lived right, I'd still have my family. That's good, buddy. You was exactly right. But don't misunderstand me. I pray for him that God restores all. I hold his name. But that's generated. Right? Same thing I said. It's not a generator. It's a good storm. But this one I'm dealing with is a guiding storm. They were in the will of God. They were with God. But now I want you to notice something. Where were they headed? They were headed to the country of the Gadarenes. Same chapter. They were headed where Jesus already knew they were going. What
on the ship. I don't get ahead of myself, but you know the story. They were afraid and thought, we're going to die in the middle of the storm. We're going to die in the will of God, and we're going to die with God with us. Now, one thing about it is you'll never find a boat sink with Jesus in it. You're not going to find a boat sink with Jesus in it. And so they were in the middle of the storm, and not only in the middle of the storm, they were with God. Now, what was the whole purpose of this? Well, I'm sure they got to the other side. They got to the other side, what happened? They met two people that were those that were possessed with the devil. Who recognized them when they got there? The devil recognized them. I'm sure somebody else might have said, man, I've seen fellas in this kind of fat boat that was out there in the middle of that storm. How did they survive that storm? See, I said, those people knew about them storms. They knew how the wind would come out of those mountains and across the sea. They knew how bad it would be. And if you were caught in the middle of it, most of the time you'd go under. But not them. All of a sudden, in the middle of that storm, it got calm. All of a sudden, in the middle of that storm, everything was fine. I seen stars out in the sunshine. All of a sudden, in the middle of that storm, it's peaceful. Why? Because Jesus stepped out, and he calmed the sea, and he spoke to the waves, and there was a calming in the middle of a guiding storm. So they get to the other side. Can you imagine when they get to the other side, how the disciples might have jumped off again and believe what he did? Can you imagine getting to the other side, and the disciples standing there, man, I'm telling you, we were in the middle of a storm, you ain't but he just stood up and he said, peace be still, and everything calmed down. Hallelujah. Can I say this? I want you to understand something. Man, that's the kind of God you and I serve, that even in the middle of the storm, he can give us peace to help us make it through it when we don't understand it. I call them guiding storms. But here's the deal. Why would God send you in a guiding storm? Well, I've thought about three things it takes to make it through the storm or a guiding storm. First of all, I just want to deal with this way. There's calamity. Anytime you're in a storm, there's going to be some residual damage. There's going to be some problems, no doubt. When you're in a storm, there's going to be some calamity. You ever seen somebody go through a tornado or something, a hurricane? They're standing out in the front yard. They're standing out in the front yard, everything's destroyed, but they're standing there alive. You know what they always say? That stuff can be replaced. But they're standing out beside of their family. Though there's calamity everywhere, they're just thankful to be alive. Can I say something to you today, and I believe this with all my heart? I believe that those storms, I say this with a little caution, but I believe sometimes God gives us a little calamity in our lives to help us to learn to trust God. You know, if things went great in our life all the time, you know what we do? We wouldn't lean on God. How often do you lean on your spare tire? Can anybody right now tell me what pressure your spare tire is in your truck right now? Do you know? Tell me what brand it is and what size it is. Tell me right now the spare tire that's in your truck. Right now, if you would, tell me who the manufacturer is. Get a flat tire on the interstate. That spare tire will come to a friend. But the only time you want it is when you have a flat. You would never appreciate it any other time. You wouldn't care. I'll be honest with you, when I'm driving that road, I don't care where my spare tire's at. I don't care what's doing. I don't care if the spare tire's back there making, you know, hissing sounds with air coming out of it, or it's fully inflated. I don't care. Why? It's a spare tire. My tires are rolling fine. I don't need it. We treat God the same way. I'm preaching right. We treat God the same way. You know what we do? As long as everything's rolling fine, we don't worry about God. But boy, as soon as we hit a storm, we go to Trump. Wouldn't it be terrible to go to Trump and the tire wasn't there? Wouldn't it be terrible to be on the side of the road and you know how to change the tire? It's really bad you don't even know how to change it. But you know how to, or you at least got tread away or something. But you know how to change the tire. And you're up in the truck, so this won't be no big deal. My wife took that tire out of the trunk in order to put some groceries in. Or my husband, his golf club, he's going to put the spark. Honey, what spark tire? We're out in the middle of nowhere. Oh, it's okay. It's in the garage of the house. You know why? Because you need it. But you know what calamity does to us?
What happens in storms, it causes us to rely on God. You have heard people say this, Pastor Crabtree, and I believe this, but sometimes, and I don't want a storm, I don't like a storm in this sense, but I want you to understand, sometimes in the middle of that storm, I've heard people say this, I felt closer to God in the storm than any other time in my life. Why is that? Because you rely on Him. In the storm, others will hear of your calamity. Second of all, others will hear of your commitment. What could they have done in the middle of that storm? When God gave me this, well, I was so excited to preach it. Because I got to think about this. How many people quit in the middle of the storm? Oh, as long as everything's going good. I hate seeing people bail out on pastors and churches. You know, we always want it high and people getting saved and God blessing and growing. And we've been blessed for that 13 years here. But there's going to be dry times. There's going to be times when a lot's not going on. There's going to be times when people's minds are depressed and struggling a little bit. Well, I think I'm just going to find me another church. Well, thank you for your commitment. We hope you enjoy the wonderful ride you had with us. Now that we need somebody to pray and go through the battle, thank you so much for sticking around. Amen. 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 Somebody say, that's good preaching. Amen. Exactly right. Praise God. Quit being a spiritual hobo. You want to go for a ride, don't want to pay nothing, just want to go. You're going to give them a ticket, you ain't going to have nothing, but you're just going to go for the ride. Then as soon as the ride don't feed you no more, that track's a little rough, I'm getting out of here. I'm doing good preaching now. I know you're quiet, like almost your church mouse, but I'm doing good preaching. Right. Understand, calamity comes. Second of all, comes with commitment. If every one of the disciples would say, I'll tell you what, I'm going to jump out of the water and wait for another boat to come by. I ain't staying on this, and that would have been dumb. You better get committed to what you're doing. And you better stick in it. Amen. Every time the first little hardship comes, I've been doing this for 31 years. There's been a lot of times when I thought, praise the Lord, man, I'm going back to the meal. I'm being honest. I worked that 10 hours in the meal. I come home, I didn't have to worry about the meal until the next day. Had another shift. Nobody in the meal's going to call me at 3 in the morning. Why? Because I was one of them hourly employees and I was done the shift. I'm done. Somebody else messed up, they deal with it. I'll be back my shift. It's about all the commitment I have. Give them a check. 2 weeks, yeah, 2 weeks, give them a check. Right? I found out 31 years of ministry, glory. You better be committed to what you do. Better be committed to what you do, because it could be 2 in the morning, 3 in the morning. Commitment. Watch this. What's the most important thing, though? Calamity we learn from, commitment others can see. But you know the most important thing about that whole deal, going from where they were to the country gatherings? Was Christ. Listen to me. During that storm, the biggest deal was Christ. You say, preacher, what do you mean? Who called him? What would the disciples have done if he hadn't come? They died, they drowned. Do you remember when they get to the other side, country of the Gadarenes? Watch this. Do you know that the devil, because the devil knows who he is anyway, but the devil, demons immediately want to know what they had to do with him. They already knew he was coming. They already knew he was coming. How'd you like to be in? He'd already been called to see. And you're in it. And you get to see it. Now he's getting ready to cast the devil. And then hogs are going to get the devil in them. They're going to run off the cliff, run down into it. Down into the water, choke the life out of them. But I want you to know this, the important thing about that godly storm was this, it was Christ. Amen. Who could get the devil out? Christ. Amen. Who could calm the storm? Christ. Amen. Who makes a difference? Christ. Amen. When God was giving me this thought, and I began just to type it up in my office, and I began to put it down, sometimes I preach with wonderful outlines that I gleaned from other men. This thought I heard in a funeral service, just a thought, probably a minute thought, and I thought, man, I can build something on that. But the outline itself, as God gave it to me, I began to think about 31 years of pastoring. And how many times I've seen the calamity, the commitment, and most of all, Christ. This storm may not be for you. You may be going through something to affect someone else. God may be allowing you through this difficult time so somebody can see commitment and can see Christ.
Amen.
How do they know your God is real? Because He puts M&Ms and Diet Mountain Dew on your table. Well, that's a good God. But how do you know it's real? Let me see what you do when it gets cloudy. Let me see how you handle it when the lightning's flashing and the thunder's rolling. Find out what you're made of. Let me see if you can make it and you can deal with it when things are hard. Preacher, you're telling me you're going to jump up and down when you go through a storm? No, I hate them. I despise them. I don't like them. I'm talking about storms. I'm not going to tell you that you think I'm going to enjoy going to Burlington and walking into two teenagers and a wife that just lost her husband, 45 years old? I don't enjoy that storm. But I do believe this. I do believe God knew that storm was coming. I know that in the Word of God. The Bible says, born in a man, once died, and I do his judgment. None of us know the appointment day for us. For some, the appointment day may be 90 years old, Miss Goldie, or 91, or 92. Maybe some of us is 45. Maybe some of us is Timmy. It was 16. Right? 16, 17. It was 15. He probably made more impact in 15 years. And some people make it seven.
Amen.
Amen. Don't you listen to me. I'll give an invitation. You get a song ready. Don't fuck it. I'll give an invitation later. That's what I'm saying. There's some of you sitting here today. Now just listen to me. You're going through generated storms because you created them yourself. And they never going to get no better until you turn off your storm machine. By the way, sometimes you're going to mess up, it's going to be way too late. You're going to lose some things you wish you hadn't lost because you generated them. You created them. You got to love my wife. My wife's a very sweet lady, my best friend. You can tell a butt's coming, right? I love her to death. She's wonderful. But she's brutally honest to me. When I crashed my dirt bike back when I first came to Calvary, it must have been just a year or two when I was here, I guess, guys, and I crashed it, compound fracture on my leg, broken back, broken wrist, Baptist Hospital, 9 surgeries in a week. They did the surgery on my wrist, and it hurt like the dickens. I don't know who the dickens are, but that's what it hurt like. And it hurt like the dickens. And I remember, down the hall from me was a girl who lost her leg in a car accident. It wasn't her fault. And my wife knew about it. Well, about 3 in the morning, you can do a lot of things that bother Miss Wendy. One of them you do not do is bother her when she wants to sleep. But I was in major pain in the hospital. They had just done major surgery on my arm. And it was major surgery on my arm. 9 surgeries on my leg. And I'm in such pain that I'm whining, complaining, griping. If God loved me. Here's what my wife said. She said, that girl down there was in a car accident, lost her leg. You chose to do what you did. Am I telling you right, baby? Just be quiet. You're the one that got on the dirt bike. You know what that was? It was a generating storm.
Why would God let that happen, Brother Chris? God didn't let that happen to Brother Chris. Brother Chris did that. Really, Honda did. Because the motor seats is wild out of KTM now. God didn't do that. Preacher, what'd you learn from that storm? I don't want to generate another one. Can I get a witness? Some of you know what I'm talking about. Generating storms. Second of all, good storms. Sometimes you're just going to go through stuff. And God's trying to make you better. Just be patient. Read James 1. Just be patient. Try in your faith and work of patience. Sometimes God's got to get you somewhere. But the third one is, and what I preach today, is a guiding storm. Sometimes you're going through it so somebody else can see, not you. Maybe your commitment, but so they can see Christ. Now listen to me. I want you to understand something. I want to make this very clear. I think I'm trying to convince God more of it than you. I do not like storms. In the sense of a, you know, not, I like the worldly storms. But you don't know that. I do not like them. Hope I don't have to go through any. But if I do, how I handle them may be where somebody else comes to Christ tonight.
Amen. Praise the Lord.
Let's stand our feet. This storm is not for you. Well, if it's generated, you may create it. If it's good, you may be growing, but maybe it's a guiding storm. And if it's a guiding storm, everybody look at me and listen to me. Church, don't end when we give an invitation. That's why churches across America today have no power. This is the birthing room. If it is a guiding storm, somebody needs to see something. She bow your head with me just a moment. It's all you can do, was that? Is it, could she play a little bit? It's quiet for me. Would you bow your head with me just a minute? Will there be someone in the auditorium today who'll say, Pastor, I'm going through a little bit of a storm in my life. It might be physical, mental, family. I'm going through a storm in my life right now. I'm going through something. Going through something. Would you pray for me? Would you slip your hand up real high? Just really high. That's all over this big auditorium. Just slip it up real high. Wow, so many hands, you put it down. Would somebody be honest in this auditorium and say, Preacher, I'm going through a storm, but I'm going to be honest with you. I feel like it's one that generated. I feel like I'm the one who caused it. I just want God to get me through it. And I feel like I'm going through a generating storm. One that I kind of created. I wonder if you'd pray for me, preacher. Is anybody that honest today? Thank you, ma'am. Someone else? Thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am. Someone there, preacher, I feel like I'm going through a generating storm. Just feel like I caused some things. Just need God to help me. I wonder today if someone will say, Preacher, I'm going through that storm. But I want people to see Christ. I want people to see God alive. Preacher, I want people to know they love Jesus. And preacher, through this storm, may somebody see the Lord. May somebody see the Lord. Would you pray that God would use me that somebody would see the Lord? I want to have you just lift that hand up real high right now. You can put it down. I have one more question. They're going to sing. You don't have to raise your hand, but I wonder if you know somebody. They might be going through a generated storm. Might be going through a good storm. God's trying to do something alive. Or they may be going through a guiding storm that somebody's got to see Christ. You don't really know yourself, but you know they're going through a storm. You know what? If I was going through that, I'd want somebody to pray for me. I'd want somebody to have a word for me. Maybe somebody in your heart
For whatever reason, this altar's open. Brother James is going to sing. You just find the Lord.
When the sword raged about them, the disciples were afraid. For the waves were high and the ship was tossed. They could not find their way. Then they awoke the Master, saying, Lord, please save us now. He rebuked the winds and the sea grew calm, and they all
understand the storm may not be from you.